I'm not young, so certainly don't consider myself to be young, and I'm not a researcher. As I said, I work in digital communications. I tend to sort of do things like make websites and write content. So I'm not really someone who can necessarily give you your best piece of advice tonight, but I have received quite a lot of good feedback from managers, some not so good, and I'd be interested if everyone can kind of think of what would actually be the worst piece of advice. We can get to that later on. But I've certainly had two pieces that, just to sort of kick off, I'd like to share that have kind of stuck with me throughout my career to date. One is building and launching a website is the easy part, the hard bit comes after the party. That's something a manager told me years and years ago in the dot-com bubble when everyone was having amazing parties. We don't even have parties anymore. But I'm sure that must translate to everyone's work in some capacity. You spend all this time building up to delivering a project, doing the proposal, getting the internal stakeholder buy-in, speaking to clients, consumers, customers about what they want. You deliver the product, and then suddenly everyone else disappears, all the agencies have gone, and certainly from my perspective, being always working in a sort of client-side environment, I'm left there staring at a user manual, trying to remember what it does and how it works, and wishing I could remember why we've made all these decisions over the last few years. So, the focus on what happens after the launch has always been a big thing for me for every project. The other thing that when I was sort of trying to think of what actually was a good piece of advice constituted actually came from my dad, who used to work on Spectator in the 60s. He always he passed down to me, "Do not be unduly deferential." And I always wondered what that meant. And I phoned him the other day and said, "Where did you get that from?" Because it sort of sounded a bit like something someone would tell you from the 60s. It actually came from Nigel Lawson, who was the then editor of the Spectator. And as my father was leaving the paper or the magazine, he said exactly that. As a young man, do not be unduly deferential. Now, I don't think that means go out there and sort of model yourself on the latest Apprentice winner, but there is something about having confidence and authority to actually challenge people, see people you're working with as an equal, as a peer, and certainly in terms of when you're going into interviews and so on. Done a lot of interviewing lately. The person you remember is the person who comes up with ideas, challenges you, puts you on a bit of the spot as well, and doesn't just sit back and kind of let other people make decisions. So those would be my two, for what it's worth, starters for 10, planning for what happens after the party and not being unduly deferential. So make that what you will. Moving on. We're going to hear from Chris Paxton in a moment. Before he takes the stage, quick bio from him. Chris is MD at Leading Edge. He started as a data inputter before the days of online research. I'm sure he might tell us a bit about that, or possibly not. And he's had 20 years' experience working with clients such as Nestlé, Nokia, Kellogg's, Pret-a-Manger, KFC, and I'm sure a lot of others. So please give me a round of applause for Chris.
Thank you.
Hey, Chris, good to
have you. All right, so I've got to balance this and the clicker as well. All right, thank you. So I just wanted to set the scene. I guess I've been working in research for 20-odd years, and when I started out, I really thought that what I was trying to do was be eager to succeed. And it's taken me a lot of years to realize that what I was actually doing was trying to be eager to please other people, eager to please my boss, eager to please my clients, eager to please my family, eager to please everybody else, really. And it's taken me, I think, over 20 years to realize that, yes, it's important to try and please other people, but it's also more important to be kind of true to yourself, I guess. And it takes a long time to get to that point. And I've been really fortunate that over my career, I've had some really great bosses. And I've had kind of three standout pieces of advice, I think, that have shaped my career. And those are what I wanted to share with you this evening. So I'll do that. This first one is kind of, this will probably ring true to lots of people. Can I just get a show of hands? Who works in works agency side? Most of you. And client side? Okay, it's just a couple. So I guess all of us are used to working and dealing with clients, right? And if you're in an agency, we've all got clients. If you're client side, you've got internal clients. So we've all got clients of some description, okay? And this one is probably my first piece of advice. Who's had difficult clients, right? We've all had difficult clients. And I remember one particular occasion where I was dealing with one of those really difficult clients. And you know those ones that want all the advice and they want the world, but they don't really want to pay for it. Yeah, and they really try and screw you down on the cost and what have you. And this was my first eager to please moment, I think, was I thought, actually, I have to please them, I should drop the cost of this and win the work, right? I guess, however, that I was sat, John Taylor, my managing director at the time, said to me, this, Chris, don't be subservient to your clients. and he said, they hire you because they want your advice, your opinion, and your help. Yeah? If you don't value what you're giving them, how will they or how can they? You know, I think that was a really poignant moment for me. It was to think about actually not a relationship that's parent to child, but it is adult to adult. And it's for mutual benefit. And I guess you think about all relationships, the best benefits, are, the best relationships are those where you both take something out of that relationship. And I think that was the one moment where it gave me confidence in myself and gave me the ability to then kind of feel confident in those relationships and kind of move on. So that's the first one that I wanted to kind of share with you. And I think that without that kind of confidence in yourself, nothing's possible. So you talked about that too, that it's kind of, you've got to start with yourself for me. That's the first kind of point. The second one that I wanted to talk to you about was this. Was that, and this one started, so I've worked in the UK for nearly 10 years, always with the same agency. Got married, thought about whether I was going to stay in the UK or go do something different. And I'm sure, like many of you have thought about, many of you may have done, I went to Australia. And I went to work with the Leading Edge, so this was in 2002. And again, it was one of those moments where I was eager to please, right? So I became one of those people that says yes to everything, right? And you can get really busy really quickly if you say yes to everything, as I found out. And you can quickly get to the stage where you're spending 12, 13, 14, 15 hours a day working on lots of different projects and trying to do your best. And I thought I was doing all right. I really did. I was working hard. I thought, you know, I'm doing all right here. And then I got that heart-sinking, can we go out and have a coffee moment. You know, when you think, something's not quite right here. So this was the advice that Nicole, who was my boss at the time, and this is another one that I've kind of carried with me. She said to me, it's not about how much you do, it's how well you do what you do, right? And that people would rather you say no than say yes and then not do it well, right? And I kind of had this belief and this kind of mentality that actually, if I just do lots of everything, then people will be happy with me. And I think, you know, this one's a kind of double-edged sword, because I'm not saying say no to everything so you only work to rule. That's not the kind of point that I'm trying to make here. And yes, there are times where we have to take on extra work and we have to do more, you know, we have to work those extra hours and stuff. But I guess with hindsight, when I look back, actually the key to my progression was about doing a doing smaller number of things really well than doing lots of things kind of average. You know, so that was the second piece of advice that I kind of wanted to share with you. And the last one, which is kind of, was the most recent one for me, really, was, again, I'll take you back. Do you remember when you were at school and you're doing exams, right? What was the one piece of advice that your teacher used to say, right? She or he used to say, when you go into the exam, read the question properly before you start, right? And who's done what I used to do all the time, which is go, I want to finish. I want to get on with it. I haven't got enough time to do this properly. And so you kick on with it, you know? And I think I look back at my career and I have this feeling that I was always passing through on the way to the next job, you know, to the next country, to the next, to the next agency, to whatever. And that I was always in a hurry to be somewhere that I actually, you know, where always on the move through to that kind of next job. And I think you have to have some degree of restlessness and ambition, right? Because, and I think that's important too. But I also think that you have to tinge that with just kind of sitting and being the best you can be today. And this kind of thought here, so don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will take care of itself. And I know that's, I've kind of been in your shoes, right? Where you're thinking, I want the next promotion, I want to work on that client and what have you. And I think that restlessness is really important. But I'll kind of, I had lunch, 2009 this was, with my CEO at the time. Everything was going well at work. I was leading a team, et cetera, et cetera. And I was, what's next? Now, for those of you, Simone, who's here from The Leading Edge as well, will know, most people actually call me Paco, right? And so this was the piece of advice that he gave me. Paco, you're always in a hurry, was what he said to me, right? He said, just focus on what you're currently doing and the opportunities will come to you, right? You don't always have to chase. And again, I thought that was really interesting because I always thought it was me that had to find that opportunity, me that had to push for that next thing. And the more that I kind of just focused on being the best that I could be today, doing the best work with the clients, you know, trying to build a team around me that were all motivated and wanted to do well, that actually opportunity started to kind of find me rather than the other way around. And I think it's important to know where you're trying to go, but if you make it a linear path and you're always striving for that next one, what I found is that some of the other opportunities that take you kind of off, that divert you, are more interesting. Yeah, and so kind of this worked for me, and I took it with a grain of salt at the time, but when I look back, I realized that, you know, probably 9-10 months after that piece of advice was given to me, my MD left from the agency I was working with in Australia, and I got that job, you know, and I tried to do that job to the best of my ability. And then we had a new group CEO came in who asked me to do a global role, and that found me out. It wasn't me that kind of strived and said, this is what I want to do. And more recently, it's brought me back to the UK. So I think this kind of is worth thinking about as well as a third point. So last slide in closing. So these are the three best pieces of advice that I have ever received. And I just try to categorize them into what they gave me. So the first one is about confidence in yourself. Others will only value you if you value yourself, right? If you believe that you're not as good as your client, as your peers, that kind of stuff, then nobody will ever value that. So try to get up onto that level playing field with your relationships, because you give as much value as the client pays for, and I think that's a really important one. Or your internal clients, it's not just about agency. Focus, so, you know, kind of try to be really specific and think about what you want to work on. So if just saying no means that you can be great at what you say yes to, right? And again, that was a big lesson for me, and you know, one that's really stuck with me. And patience, yeah, which is one I'm really bad at. But new and interesting options will find you if you focus on being the best that you can be today. Those things will come and search you out. And those pieces of advice, like I say, have come to me through three really great bosses. They've gotten me to where I am today, and given me the opportunity to talk to you about it tonight. So thank you very much.
Very good. Thank you. Very good.
Okay. Why are you called Paco?
Paxton got short into Paco. Yeah, it was from that first job.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Moving swiftly on. I'd like to welcome Claire Phillips, who has spent 10 years advising broadcasters on platform, channel, and program brands. Most recently for Channel 4, also BBC, and worked on award-winning campaigns for EastEnders, BBC 3 and CBeebies.
Yeah, thank you. So when I was thinking about this talk, I thought I'd quite like to work out how many days of our lives we're actually going to be spending at work. Because I know I spent a lot of time at work, but I was trying to work out how many more days have I got to go. So I don't know if any of you can what it is. Can any of you tell me how many days you think you might spend at work in your lifetime?
28,000.
No. Oh, James is here. This is a really good piece of advice. Don't be late when you're speaking. It's actually, James, I'm going to give you a question. This is so mean. Mm-hmm. How many days do you think you are going to spend at work in your life?
Five times 250. 1,300.
close. It's actually 10,560. I've probably done it wrong, but I think I've done it right. 10,560 days out of a total of 28,470 days. Now, this is all averages. So if you're working from the age of 21 to 65, you're working 5 days a week, you work 48 weeks a year, gets you to 10,560 days out of 28,000, because we're all going to, on average, we'll live till we're 78. And I think that's a pretty sobering thought, because that's over a third of our lives we'll be spending at work. So what I really think we need to do is make sure that the time we spend at work is the most happy and fulfilling and rewarding time we can possibly have, because, you know, it sounds like a cliche, but clichés are true. You've only got one life and you're not going to repeat it, so you might as well make sure that the third of your life you spend at work is really, really fun. My advice actually doesn't come from any of my bosses. actually comes from this book, and I don't know how many people have read this book. Has anyone read it? Ah, good. Well, you can see I've completely cribbed this, the rest of the speech. So Tina Fey is a brilliant comedian, and she is the writer of 30 Rock, and she was the head writer, first female head writer of Saturday Night Live. And she's written an autobiography called Bossy Pants. And I think it is really one of the best business books I have ever read. Business books are usually really, really boring. This is very, very funny. And the reason it's excellent is because she draws a really interesting analogy between improvisation, which is what she's brilliant at, and successful career. And there's just four lessons that I've taken from it. So the first one is agree and say yes.
As opposed to saying
that. Yeah. But we'll work it round, it will be seamless. So she says, when you're in improvisation and you're starting a scene and somebody says, so I'm working with James, I'm so picky on you tonight, I'm in. And I say, freeze, I've got a gun. Okay? James, and if James says to me, that's not a gun, it's your finger, then you're pointing a finger at me, then our improvised scene has absolutely ground to a halt and we're not going anywhere. But if I say to James, freeze, I've got a gun, he goes, I can't believe it, the gun I gave you for Christmas, how could you? Then suddenly we've got a scene and we can start kind of moving forward. Being agreeable and saying yes at all times is obviously not the thing that we should always do at work, because there'll be some people that you don't like very much at work and some people that you won't agree with. And some of you might think that you've always got the most brilliant ideas compared to everybody else. But I think what she's really saying here is being open-minded and respecting other people and respecting your partner. And even if you think that the person opposite you is going to say something really stupid, just let them speak first and let them have their say. Because actually, when you work in an environment where people are open-minded and willing to listen to other people, you'll find that you're working in a much more innovative environment where brilliant ideas happen, and it's a lot more fun to work with, because nobody likes to work with a person who says, no, that's not going to work. Everybody wants to work with a person who's willing to go with ideas and think innovatively. So the second rule, according to Tina Fey, is to say not just yes, but to say yes and. So again, if we're back to improvisation, you don't just say yes when somebody starts a scene, and you add to it. So if I'm Tina Fey and I say, I can't believe it's so hot in here, and you just say, yeah, then we're kind of at some kind of stalemate. But if you say, what do you expect? We're in hell. Then suddenly it means that you've contributed something to the story, and again, you've moved it on. So this is really about contributing and not being the person in the office who doesn't say anything and doesn't add to the discussion. And it's your responsibility to contribute to things. So clocking in and out every day when you come into work and doing the bare minimum means that you're not really the kind of person who's going to get noticed and leave a mark, and you're not really going to get on. So the third one is a classic, really, which is think of solutions, not questions. And again, she draws this analogy with improvisation. And here she says, you don't want to, when you're doing improv, you don't want to riddle your partner with questions. So you say yes, followed by an assertion. So if you're in a scene and you're always saying, who are you? What's in the box? what are we doing next? Then it puts a whole load of pressure on your partner. And nobody wants to be in that situation. So the adage of don't bring me problems, bring me solutions is really, really true here. And there will be times at work where there is an absolute crisis and something's not going to plan. But rather than run to your boss and say, it's all going wrong, something's not going to plan, think about how you might solve it first and then approach your boss with okay, I've got a way that we can fix this and this is what I think we should be doing. Because adding nothing but asking questions is really, really draining. And it's kind of excluding yourself from being part of the solution. And it's about building obstacles rather than bridges. And you want to be the kind of person who's building bridges rather than obstacles. So the last one is, although we might not want to admit it, we are always going to fail sometimes. And that's okay. And because Tina Fey says it's okay. So she talks about, in improvisation again, she says, if I start a scene as what very clearly I think is a policeman riding a bicycle, but you think I'm a hamster in a hamster wheel, then I'm not going to stop and explain that actually what I'm actually riding a bike, I'm actually going to go with it. And I'm going to say, yep, I'm a hamster in a hamster wheel. But she said, what I might do is I might start ending up being a police hamster who's been put on hamster wheel duty because I'm too much of a loose cannon in the field. So she says, in improv, there are no mistakes. There's only very happy accidents. And as we know, lots of amazing discoveries in life have been made through happy accidents. And she tells this story about her boss, Lorne Michaels, who was the guy who was the creator and the guy responsible for Saturday Night Live. And he often used to tell her, the show doesn't go on because it's ready, it goes on because it's 11:30, which has meant his point was the show is live, and whether or not the show is perfect, it had to go out, it has to go out at 11:30, which is why sometimes some of the sketches they had weren't as brilliant as she would have hoped. And I think sometimes things won't go to plan, but the lesson here really is to not worry if things don't go to plan, and just to be open-minded and to adapt to change, because you actually might find that something better might come out of it. And the last point, I suppose if you're adding all these, some of these together, are really about respect, creating, contributing, and adapting. And I think if you bear all these qualities in mind, of respecting others, creating and contributing, and being happy to adapt, then I think you will, and if you show these values, then I think people will recognise you and recognise your ability and really importantly enjoy working with you. Because I think one of the things that I've definitely found is that, and I think Chris talked about it, is that you don't think about your career as a kind of linear path, and you've got this, you're constantly on the move to get to the next promotion. Because actually I think really careers now are about networks of people. And if you show these values at work, then I think you'll build up a network of people that you have worked with and come across who rate you, value you, like working with you. And you will find that suddenly opportunities come your way when you hadn't necessarily expected it. And it's often those are some of the career opportunities that are the most exciting. So I think hopefully if you think about addressing these values at work, when we think about the fact that we're going to spend 10,560 days of our life at work, we'll look back on those days and we'll look back on those days with fondness and with satisfaction and few regrets.
Very good. Very good. Thanks, Claire. I'd like to think that tonight's got an air of improvisation about it. Next, we've got John Priest, who is CEO of SPA Future Thinking Group, which includes Future Thinking France, Central Research, and the Analytics Hub. John's also just been made an MRS Fellow. So, congratulations, John. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you. I just press this, right?
Yep.
I didn't know so many people. Look at that, we're having a great time in the front row. I can't see you at all. Yeah, it's nice to meet you all. Thank you for coming. And we're going to do some audience participation in my bit. So that means I'm going to pick on someone in a minute. Now just go with it, all right? Don't sort of stay rooted in your chair saying, oh, I don't want to. It's not going to be you, James, either. It has to be one of the delegates who are coming. So just work with me. So obviously it's going to be someone near the end of the row. Those people who've already eye contact. They've got their arms folded in a defensive manner at the back. But then invariably attract my attention. What's your name?
Amy.
Amy. You don't have to speak, it doesn't work. Just for the video. And what do you work at, Amy?
Opinion leader.
Would you like to help me out with this?
Sure. Yeah.
Come with me. Can you give Amy a big round of applause? Okay, there's the microphone. Okay, now take centre stage and address the audience, okay?
Good evening, everybody.
Well done. Confident. Obviously, I've chosen well. Now you have to use that and just move it on to one chart, the next chart, and just read out what it says. Okay? Very good.
The only thing to do with good advice is to pass it on. It's never of any use to oneself. Oscar Wilde.
Very good. Thank you. And a huge round of applause. Thank you. Thank you so much, Amy. Opinion, there you are. Why I asked you to do that is, I've got four bits of advice, and the next chart is the first bit of advice. And I've structured the bits of advice to be about market researchers in your career development. So advice number one is if you are up to 5 or 6 years into your career, kind of like project manager or even associate director level, you might think it seems to just call that a junior research pool, but at a macro level it kind of is, I'll explain why towards the end. But if you're kind of 5 years in, I'll give you one piece of advice, which I was never given, I might add. And you've just done it, Amy, thank you. Is take an experiential view to everything that you research and study. So quite often you'll get a research brief, you'll work on it, write a proposal, write a questionnaire, do a discussion guide on subjects that you've personally never ever experienced at all. This happened not a while ago with one of our clients, KFC, into bargain buckets, which wasn't an account that people fought over. But rather than buy and use them, they did a shift at a KFC on a Saturday, paid to do so, KFC rates. And they just learnt about the product from a completely different perspective by using it. Sometimes you're asked to research things that are not personally relevant to you, watching a particular TV channel, listening to a radio station, travelling on network rail, whatever things that you personally don't do, it's very hard to have a research solution if you don't have the basis of empiricism, yeah, which is experience. The best bit of advice that was given to me by Ruth Simons, who co-founded what has become SPA Future Thinking, that was 20 years ago. Okay, now Ruth was 23 when she started the agency with me, and I was 29, so obviously we didn't have any good bosses to learn from. So we've actually had to make it up as we went along. But she'd actually said, where research works best is if you personally consume yourself in the product or service, and it gives you a credibility and an insight and a language and a flair, particularly when the subject is of no relevance to you. So next time you work on a project, or you're gonna help write the easy parts of a proposal, if you're 5 years into your career, don't worry, it will get better. Think, actually, I'm gonna go and use it or buy it. Not talk to people who do, so that's the research part. I'm going to personally become a temporary consumer and know what it's like, in this case, to stand up and hold a pretend mic and talk to people, because it gives you an understanding and a depth that you don't get doing it sort of in the abstract. Is that all right? I thought that was quite a good one to begin with. It did two things. It was original and also it got a bit of audience participation going. I thought so. XTC, one of my favourite bands. Number two is when you're 10 years into your research career, kind of. So you're kind of research director or client service director, you've got director in your name, you're not legally bound as a director in terms of Companies House, you think you are, that's never explained to you, by the way, if you work agency side, you're a director, kind of. You have a revenue responsibility, you have key clients that you have to deal with, and there's quite a lot of stuff that you have to do as a director, which is like inverted commas management. Nothing to do with doing research projects quite so much. Keeping clients happy, thinking about ideas, helping run the agency, okay? A lot of demands on your time. It's a really good piece of advice, and it's not mine. It's been nicked from Facebook, this particular thing here. Done is better than perfect, or done is better than perfection. It's so true. People faff so much. This is a great quote from General Patton. A good plan violently executed right now is far better than a perfect plan executed next week. And people think things are going to be perfect. They don't have to be. And particularly when you're at that director level, you're going to do so many things that aren't about doing research, checking expenses, or going to meetings, or coming up with ideas, or checking expenses, or filling expenses. Just do them quickly and get on with it. And related to it is an interesting piece of advice I've got, which is it's the small things that really matter. If you're in the delivery job of doing work at an agency for a client, it's a culmination of a lot of little things that go wrong that really break the relationship. There's not a project that goes bandy, because you can change that next time, or you can save it often. But if you don't do with the things you say you're going to do when you're going to do them, or if things are late, or if things have got typos in them, or if you promise stuff and then you don't do it, they add up. Just get it done. It doesn't have to be perfect. I mean, there is a researcher at SPA Future Thinking, whose name I won't mention, who is on his seventh, or was on his 17th, that 17th version of a report deliverable to a client. Because the full stop was being moved around and the titles were being changed. Anyway, I got wind of this and we had a very short conversation around the fact that I doubt that the amount of time spent perfecting something would even be noticed by the end client. You have to be pragmatic. Done really is much better than perfect. Good piece of advice. Again, I kind of nicked that one. It's not one that was given to me. Remember the quote that Amy gave me? Now you're kind of 15 years into your research career. You're a managing director or a group MD or a CEO like me or a chief operating officer. And there's lots of other things you have to do that aren't to do with research at all, about running businesses and revising articles of association and buying companies and borrowing money and doing all sorts of stuff. The best quote you can ever get is absolutely true. Do not expect others to care as much as you do. Okay. Unless you learn another related lesson, which is if you want to run a company, spread the equity as thin as you can. Give everybody some skin in the game. Share options are a good idea. But don't expect somebody who owns, I don't know, 35 grand a year to be happy about working the weekend for you, who's earning significantly more than that, and who owns 50% of the company. They're not going to be as motivated, funnily enough. They really aren't. And that's fine, because that's the way of the world. Their time will come later if things go through and if you listen to the advice I'm sharing with you, right? But frankly, what you do is you work with it, and I say to my bosses, oh, so-and-so really mucked up. They were working late. And I said, well, you should expect that. They shouldn't. Why are you expecting them to care as much as you do? This is cited in Chris Evans's rather surprisingly good autobiography, the first version, not the second one. I thought that's very true. I was going to have a picture of like a tower block or an office block at night with just one light on and someone working alone. I thought it's slightly cliched. I thought that's also give the impression that's what I did too, so I don't get anymore. But it's very true. Is that managements make mistakes by expecting all the rank and file at whatever level you're at to be equally motivated, and knowing that they're not gives you an angle on management. It's very, very important. Okay. Now the final piece of advice is kind of when you're sort of a bit beyond that and you're doing other bits and pieces, you kind of look back retrospectively about if you've had a success in your career or if you've done all the things that you hoped you would do. And this is the only piece of advice that I personally either came up with or agreed with based on the film Moneyball, or rather the book Moneyball, The Art of Winning an Unfair Game by Billy Beane, general manager of the Oakland Athletics. Some of you may have seen the film with Brad Pitt in it. Really good film. Coming up with a methodology of how to win, which was completely unique. But one thing, and it's a great metaphor for modern business management actually, this is a quote I really like. It's absolutely true. and it's true for me. I hate losing more than I want to win. And there is a difference. If I'm pitching to some esteemed, well-regarded, well-respected, big-budget client like James, BBC, we are on the roster anyway, and we win the business, James, just saying, then I go, we're happy. Well, I'm happy for 5, sometimes 6 minutes. Then we get on to the job. If I don't win, I'm desolate for 5 or 6 days, okay? fear of losing, yeah, is much more motivating than the desire to win. It's not about it being a zero-sum game. It's not about winning at all costs. But if you hate losing, but you hate losing more than you want to win, and you note that there is a difference, then I've personally found that, just from a business perspective, to be an important personal mantra. And anyway, you don't need any of the things I've told you, particularly. I do quite like this quote from Benjamin Franklin. Wise men just don't need advice, and fools won't take it anyway. So as you are probably qualifying in that regard, you've already got all the advice that you need. Thank you so much.
Okay, thanks, John. James, glad you could make it. James is Director of Audiences at the BBC. He took a modern languages degree before joining BMRB, is this true? Before joining BMRB's graduate programme, and has been at BBC for about 10 years now, is that right?
I have, yes.
Over to you. Now,
you might need that clicker, or you might not.
Is this on? Well, I haven't got any slides, so
well, you won't need
I'm clickling.
The mic's on, no, but yeah, it's not being amplified. It's just for the video.
No, you need it.
You need to.
Oh, yeah. Right, okay. Fine. I just wanted to go back to one of the Johns. The whole done is better than perfection bit, as a client, I never, ever, ever want to hear anybody saying that to me.
I'll behave yourself. Seriously. You're just teasing.
Seriously, perfection is what you're after. All time. Not even a hint of something not done to the best of your I've got that slide. So John's one about advice I think is really helpful. You can hear loads of different sound of stuff and from everybody today. And I would say you're all different. There are 62 million people in this country, and all of these people are different. They've got different personalities. They've got different internal wiring, different talents and different skills. So pick out the bits that are the most used to you, because you are an individual, and it's really important that you are able to flourish as an individual. And I want to talk a little bit about that. One of the people who's been most useful in shaping my career was a guy called Chris Mundy, who was my first boss when I was at the BBC, who some of you would have worked with. And he was very helpful to me. I was a slightly frustrated man in my 20s, not going anywhere, kind of plodding around in the junior ranks at the BBC, but not really sure what I wanted to do. And Chris spent a lot of time with me just saying, are you enjoying yourself? Why are you doing this? Are you still learning new things? Are you actually in stretch? If you're not, then the nicest possible I'll bugger off and do that to somebody else. I spent a lot of time chatting to him and really working out. He said, what are you best at? So I said, oh, okay, that's really helpful. Work out the things I'm best at and what are the things that actually I really like doing. And I wrote them down as well, and actually there's quite a lot of things that they had in common with each other, would you believe? And he said, well, why don't you go and find a job that actually involves doing some of those kind of things? So I did. And I went off to work on BBC News, and I managed people and did lots of kind of things that were really me, and I really, really enjoyed. And ever since then, my career has done really well. And I'll talk about luck and timing as well later, because you kind of need those. It's not just about what you do. And I thought that was really sage advice, on kind of find out what you want to do, what you're good at, what you like doing, and then find a job. Until I talked to Claire about this at lunchtime, and she said, actually, it's not remotely unique advice. And actually, someone's written a whole book about this, which is a guy called Jim Collins. He's written a book called Good to Great, and apparently this is part of a huge thing called the Hedgehog Principle. So I thought it was great wisdom, but actually, it would appear lots of people are doing it. But the point really is that not everybody has to be brilliant at project management. I'm hopeless at project management. Not everybody has to be good at people management. Focus on what you're really good at. Not everybody has to work client side. I mean, yes, it's great, but I get an awful lot of people coming for interviews saying, yeah, well, I just want to kind of be client side. And they're not sure why. I mean, we still have, it's good, but there are still problems there. And you've got to make sure that, you're doing things for the right reasons about why you want to do it. There is no single right path, and it's within you guys, all of you, to find out what you want to do and what you're going to most enjoy. But ask a lot of questions while you're about it. So that's that one. The other thing I really wanted to talk about is we talk so much about skills and capabilities and learning stuff, and we don't talk enough about behaviours. And we spend an awful lot of time in our recruitment process and in our development process talking about behaviours. So not just about what you do, but about how you do it, and in particular how you do it with other people. And I would say, formally, on behalf of the BBC, I recruit far more around behaviours and people's inherent curiosity than I ever do about experience and skills. I mean, you know, clearly, if you've got a background in research, that is handy, and you probably won't get your interview. But when it comes to the interview, I'm trying to find about you. I'm trying to find out how you're going to engage and interrelate with everybody else in the team, and what kind of a person you are, and how you're going to, you know, make us look good. As Claire said, I think the mistakes bit is really important. Everyone makes mistakes. I've made lots. But if you make mistakes, own up and deal with it and move on. Don't beat yourself up forever, but don't try to hide it equally. Never put down in email what you don't want to say to somebody face-to-face, because it'll come out. All of these things are just about being, I would say, a decent, straightforward human being. If you're going to, you know, give people praise in public, if you've got everybody should get criticism and feedback if things aren't right, but do it privately in a place where people can deal with it. All of these things are just about how you are and will help you succeed far more in what you want to do. Always try to hire people who are better than you is something I've done an awful lot of. It's a sign of strength, it's not a threat, it's brilliant when you've got people who are better than you. It's mildly annoying that they come up with all the answers, but at the same time, they ultimately will make you and your team look good. If you're working with clients, they will make you look good in front of your clients. It's a win-win, it really is. I make a lot of assumptions about things and people, and it took me quite a long time to realise that part of my frustration was because I thought I knew where people were coming from, and most of the time I was wrong. I thought they were coming from where I was coming from, which isn't always a wonderful thing. So ask lots of questions, find out where people are thinking, about what they think you're feeling. And the third, I suppose, big thing I wanted to talk about was luck and timing, which isn't really about advice I've received, but it's well, it is a bit. It's for my mother, so it's never a great thing to turn up in a professional thing. So, your mother has been a large influence on your career. So. But my mother, I remember when I was, again, a junior soul kind of going, she was going, well, I said, oh, it's a new job camp as an SRE. And she said, well, are you going to go for it? I said, well, it's not really my term, because somebody else started in the agency 3 months before me. So it's not. And she said, don't be so bloody stupid. So, of course, I went for it, and I didn't get it. But, you know, the theory... It is right, and I've been for loads of jobs that I haven't got, and some of them I'd have been great for, and some of them I wouldn't. But and equally, I've probably, I don't know how many interviews I've done in my life, probably 500 people in my life, and some of them have been really, really great, they've just been in the wrong place at the wrong time. I've needed a really creative thinker, and somebody's been a brilliant project manager, and if I had different people in the team, it would have been very different. So there's no right or wrong. Luck and timing play a huge, huge role in your early careers in particular. So don't be put off if you don't get something. I mean, it might be you, get feedback and build on stuff, but equally it might not be. It's just if they've really got five people who are, you know, brilliant at X in the team, they probably don't need a sixth. They want somebody to be different, and it's just life. So just keep trying. And finally, last thing to say really, work is only part of your life. Some people allow it to be all of your life, and if you want to, that's totally fine. But I have found that some of the most impressive people who I have worked with, you know, as suppliers or within my organisation, are those who found proper balance. So when they come, they absolutely give their all. And when they're away, you know, they have a life outside. So find a balance that works for you and do things that are going to make you happy. I'm not sure how many people have turned around on their deathbed and go, oh, I wish I'd worked another extra couple of Sunday afternoons. I imagine most of them would rather have a bit more time with their friends or family. So that's me. Good luck.
Okay, thank you, James. So lastly, we've got John Griffiths. He has been a communications planner for over a quarter of a century. you're regretting saying that. With stints as a creative director, Magic Duster, tech affiliate, Meta Guru.
They said that.
Sound familiar? Between his writing commitments and playing with his band, he runs Planning Above and Beyond. So over to you, John.
Thank you. Right. So don't confuse me, James Holden. Once you move the slide on.
Actually, the first thing it's probably worth saying is don't wait for anyone to say, I've got a piece of advice for you, because you'll be waiting an awful long time, because no one ever did say that to me. So therefore, what I'm going to talk to you about is really about how I realized that advice was being given to me and what I did with it. The first thing I want, if no one's told you this, is that you're an apprentice. Not after that horrible television program that I refuse to watch. But market research isn't that big. Take a good look at each other, because you're going to be hanging out with each other at conferences and everything else for the next few years. So be nice to each other. Don't be too nice to each other. don't be horrible to each other, because it comes around. And there's something really special about that, which is that you are part of a group of people who help each other. Now, this sounds terribly folksy and takes us right back to Woodstock. But I was talking to a guy called Simon Patterson at the research conference this year, and we were talking by the bar, planting some ideas, talking about stuff. And following a conversation we had, he mailed me last week and said, I did it. What had he done? He and Lawrence Bailey, you probably wouldn't know him either, had gone to interview Bill Schlachman. Now, most of you wouldn't know who Bill Schlachman was. He pretty much was one of those who invented qualitative research in this country. He made it up. I mean, it's a stupid idea. The idea that we put people on couches or put people on groups for a therapeutic thing actually has use in business and social research. It's an idea. Somebody made it up. You are part of that group of people. And that's just a very recent story as a reminder that you're part of that group. And so there are people you can learn from. If you turn around and ask someone, because you discover they were the first person to do this, or they wrote about it, they won't tell you to go away before they found out where you're from, whatever. They'll tell you, they'll help you. Accountants, I gather, don't say something really important happened in 1997, and I read about it in a textbook. In research, we still work in oral history, and I think that's really, really important, and you should know that and benefit from it. I just want to say that as a start. So therefore, I wind back in my long career, 25 years. Was I lying? Was I telling the truth? You can ask me afterwards. I went to an MRS training course, as I'm sure many of you have been on, and various people, like Wendy Gordon and Roy Langmaid, Roddy Glenn, Joanna Shinovska, Rebecca Winberg, people you won't necessarily know, but they were there. But they're there because they're like markers in my head. And I went to this conference, this course, and did the training. And Roy talked about the norms of research. This is a qualitative research course, I hasten to add. And he talked about forming and norming and storming and forming and all those sorts of good things which happen in focus groups. And it wasn't until I got back to my ad agency and I was there the next morning that I went into a meeting. And we were pitching a TV script to a client, and the account director, presented the idea, and the client came back and picked on something really, really stupid. And the account director said, no, you've really missed the point. This is fine, whatever. And the client came back and said, well, really, I also had some other concerns about this and that. The account director said, no, you know, you're really missing the point of this. Don't you get this at all? And I was still kind of in my head from the course the previous day. And I thought, hang on, there's group dynamics going on here. What's going on is the client's storming, and instead of going, yeah, and just letting it go, we're challenging it, whatever. Well, cut a long story short, an hour later, the TV script was completely blown. Quite nice, actually, quite a nice script, using the soundtrack of Cool for Cats. We'll never see the light of day. But the point was, I suddenly realized that everything I'd learned about doing research was useful for everything else. In business, it made me better at my job. It made me better with people. It made me a better listener. This will not only enhance your professional lives, but hopefully enhance your personal lives. Actually, the worst thing my wife ever said to me, I should actually get you to write it down and tell me. She said, can I be one of your respondents? I'd get more attention.
Ooh. Harsh.
Ooh. Harsh. But she had a point. Okay, those listening skills are really, really important. And as soon as I realized that in every meeting, that in every client meeting, I've even got a presentation kicking around somewhere, which is how to run every client meeting like a focus group. Because as soon as you understand that it's actually about interrogating, not the thing which is being talked about. I have actually worked on a project where I discovered halfway through that the client thought they were going to lose their job. That was the point of the entire project. I should have found that out in the first meeting if I'd been better. So that whole thing about saying what's really going on, what's the emotional stuff, isn't simply a technical exercise because it helps you do your job. It makes you better at everything that you do. So that was the first kind of breakthrough for me in terms of realizing how useful all of this was in these other areas. And building on from that, I just started to pay attention to the things that I was reading about, learning about, and so on to make me better at my job. How else would that make me be better? And another person who was a tremendous help to me was someone called Jill Arrow, who was one of the people who kick-started conversation discourse analysis and conversation analysis, took it out of academia and brought it into research. And so I worked with her on a few projects. And I realized that, well, People not only say things in particular ways, they use particular metaphors, they even avoid saying certain things. Even if you're looking at something someone has handwritten, they'll start to say something and rub it out and then say something else. It's a dead giveaway because human beings leak. We can't. If human beings didn't leak, we wouldn't have a job. So that kind of leakage, once you get sensitized to it, you can hear the way people say things. You can listen, not to the sense of what's being said. I'm sure lots of you know this, but my point is, why leave it at work? You can use it all over the place. And so that's simply another example. And I would argue that online transcriptions, whatever else, that once you develop a sixth sense and learn almost not to switch off, it is good to switch off sometimes, but not to switch off and simply to use these kind of enhanced senses that you've picked up professionally, they have use in working with colleagues, working with clients, and all of that. So they were simply to say, use those skills and repurpose them as you go. The next exhibit I wanted to bring to you is a quotation. I ran an interview last year with someone who was one of, if actually probably the first account planner. It's just a little project I ran last year. I just decided, having a background in account planning, that I would go and talk to the first planners ever that I could find, and I found the first one. And the interesting thing about this character, he started off as an LSE stats graduate. I'm sure there might be even one or two of them here now. And he started off doing qualitative research when qualitative research was quite new. And he worked up through his agency, which was BMP, which has changed its name a couple of times. It is now DDB, Adam and Eve. And they're quite sore about it, the ex-BMP is about the fact that the name's changed over and over again. But he then went further to be the chairman of BBDO and on the Omnicom board. At the same time, he was passionate about racehorses. He used everything he learned to make himself better at betting. He ran a whole business on the side doing that. So he became president of the Racehorse Owners Association, became founder of the British Horse Racing Board, which took over from the Jockey Club, and then he joined the Tote Board, and then he became the chairman of the Tote. So professionally, I would argue, compared with an awful lot of researchers, he's up there. He's out there. Unbelievable. And this is what he said to me. This is a verbatim from our conversation last year about doing research. You also have to have the ability, of course. It was hard work, but immensely rewarding to do the groups ourselves, and I didn't have a great deal of experience in doing qualitative research, but I learned a lot from Crina. Crina, by the way, is Crina Lodge, if anyone has ever heard of the new business consultancy, new product consultancy, Creighton Lodge and Knight. That's where it came from. She was one of the first. It needs a certain technique to be able to just listen rather than talk. To be able to manage, now I've been the chairman of quite a few companies, it's quite helpful, I always found, to let people have their say and then draw conclusions from it rather than try and tell them what you want them to think yourself. I just thought that was a really simple quotation, but a lovely example of someone who is doing deals. I told him I was going to see Leslie Butterfield at Interbrand the following week. He said, yeah, I bought Interbrand. That's how big he is. That's how senior he is in the whole firmament. But he was someone who, on a day-to-day basis, considers himself to be using his research skills when he does it. So what you're learning now, however far you want to go, wherever you want to take it, you're going to be able to use it. I shall finish with a last, absolutely last piece of advice, which I was given by a respondent last Friday, which was when I was paying them in a car park. and said, could we use the envelopes next time? I said, yeah. Yeah, fine. Yeah, we'll do that. I said, yes, it is a bit embarrassing because it makes me look like a drug smuggler. She said, no, it's worse than that. We just got out of a car with you and you gave us 50 quid. We look like prostitutes. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, thank you. Can I just get a general round of applause for all our speakers?